What's up, everybody, and welcome to Real Time for the Real Everyday Movie Fan. I'm Ryan Murphy, and I'm very pleased to have as my guest today Mr. Kenneth Johnson, longtime creator of film and television, writer, director. You might know him as the creator of television series like The Incredible Hulk, V, The Bionic Woman, and plenty of other stuff as well on his resume. Mr. Johnson, thank you very much for being here today.
You're welcome, Ryan, but please, it's Kenny. Everybody calls me Kenny. My father was Kenneth, and I was a junior, so I was always called Kenny by my family, and now by my cast and crew. At least that's what they call me to my face,
Well, awesome. Thanks again for being here. And sure. So for a lot of people out there, the first thing that comes to my mind when I'm looking at this career of yours is you kind of went a different way from a lot of writer-directors out there. A lot of writer-directors, they start writing, and that's their love. That's what they do, and then directing sort of comes out of that. And so for you, it seems like it happened the opposite way around. You said, I want to direct, and then in order to get directing jobs, you had to start writing stuff.
Well, yeah, that's part of what happened when I came to California. I studied at the drama department at what is now Carnegie Mellon University, and as a directing major at Carnegie, it was a theater school. There was no film or television, and when I was looking at the catalog just before I applied to the college, I saw that they had lots of different disciplines that you can study: lighting design, costume design, production design, theater management, acting, and I saw all the classes that they got and how individualized they were. But then the directing major had to take them all. And the idea was that if you're going to be a director, you got to know as much as you can about everything. And so I did that. And the one class that was always the hardest for me was writing. I just never thought of myself as a writer. As a director, yeah, that sort of came naturally and always had. And that's learning to work with actors on the boards. We were taught the Stanislavski method of building a character and how an actor prepares and getting inside of it and everything. And then working as a director on the stage in the theater with actors, which is something that a lot of film school students don't get. One of the first things I always tell to all of my students at various film schools that I've taught is take acting classes, so that you can really learn to speak to actors. But I just never thought of myself as being a writer, and I just didn't think I was very good at it. And when I first came to California, after having quite a fair amount of success back east in New York and on a couple of national shows back there that I was directing and producing, and I came out here, and my pal Stephen Bochco, who had been at Carnegie with me, and I was actually sleeping on his couch when I first came out here, and he said, Kenny, if you're a writer, you can control your destiny, because if you're an actor, you can do bit parts and work your way up. If you're a writer, you can write on spec, but if you're a director, they don't want to give you the money to direct until they've seen that you can do it for somebody else, so it's a bit of a catch-22. And I said, but Steve, I don't know how to, I just hate it. And he said, no, you trust me, you can do it. And I started I started writing. I wrote with a couple of writing partners and with Steven on a couple of things, too, and discovered, I can. I'd seen enough theater productions. I'd heard enough dialogue from actors in both the theater and movies to see that that I really had an ear for dialogue and that I could fashion a story if I just took my time and put my nose to the grindstone. And I started writing, and I became a great writer, Ryan, of unproduced screenplays. A lot of them are still on my shelf here at my office in Sherman Oaks. But each time I wrote a script, even if it didn't get bought by somebody, at least I learned something and how to do it better, I thought. And finally, one of the scripts I wrote, Steve got particularly excited about. And he had already introduced me around at Universal to another young guy named Steve Cannell, who this was just before Steve had created the Rockford Files. He was still a story editor. And we the three of us were sort of the class of 1980 at Universal Studios. And both of them were really helpful and instrumental in sort of getting my foot in the door at Universal. And first, as a writer, I wrote some episodes for Steve Cannell and also for Bochco on a couple of their shows. And then Cannell finally arranged to get me a directing gig on one of them, and we, you know, did pretty well. And Bochco gave one of my spec scripts to Harve Bennett, who was then executive producer of a lot of big miniseries and such. But he was also doing this show called The $6 Million Man. And they were in their first full season and really short on scripts and desperate for ideas. And he read my screenplay, this feature screenplay, and he said, "Look, I can't help you get that produced, but I like your writing, and would you like to bring me some ideas for the $6 Million Man?" And the first one that I brought to him was The Bionic Woman. And he liked it, and I wrote it. And then I wrote it again and made it longer, twice as long. And in the course of that, Harve invited me to join him as a writing producer on The $6 Million Man. And I said, "You know, gosh, Harve, you know, producing's kind of a pain in the neck. I'd rather just write and direct. Can we do that?" And he said, and maybe you've heard me say this somewhere, is that he said, "Well, Kenny, in television, it's the producer that controls the medium, and the producer gets to hire the writer and the director." And as soon as I heard that, I said, "Okay, that's a job I would take," and so that I was able to hire myself. And, you know, that's how it happened. So directing was definitely first, and it's still my favorite thing to do, Ryan. If somebody told me, you know, I could never write again, I could only direct, I'd say, "Oh, that's too bad. Which way to the set, you know?" But if they said you can only write and not direct anymore, I'd go, "Which way to the cliff?" You know, I just would want to jump off. But so it's I've been very lucky and enjoyed a good career, and fortunately was able to make the transition by way of writing. And it, again, with my film students, one of the ways that I tell them to get a job, particularly if they're trying to get a directing job, is to learn to write. And that can be an avenue that will get you on board, and particularly if you write something that somebody wants to buy.
Yeah. So, I mean, yeah, you created the Bionic Woman, and then I know that you were offered the Incredible... You were offered your choice of Marvel superheroes, and you turned them down until it was... Les Miserables you were reading at the time.
Yeah, right? That's true. It's a true story. And Frank Price, then head of Universal, had bought the rights to five of the Marvel comic superheroes. And I just didn't want to do that kind of stuff. I was trained in the classic theater, Ryan. You know, I thought of myself as a bit more high class and upscale and comic books. No. And I was really trying to figure out how to say no, but my wife, Susie, you're correct, had given me a volume of the Les Miserables, which I had never read. And so I had Jean Valjean and Javert pursuing him and the fugitive kind of concept in my head. And I realized that there was a way to take a little bit of that Victor Hugo and perhaps a touch of Robert Louis Stevenson's Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde and blend it with this sort of silly comic book premise of the Incredible Hulk and try to elevate it out of being a comic book. I really wanted to base it more on the Greek tragedies, which are generally spurred by a hero who is messing with things better left to the gods. You know, the idea of hubris, which is the Greek word for meaning false pride, when someone thinks they are no better than anybody else, and then they attempt something, and then the gods don't like it when you do that. And in Banner's case, he was trying to find strengths that he felt all humans had, and overdosed himself out of a desire to conquer this obsessive quest he had, and oops, he brought down a curse upon himself instead. And so it was really based on the Greek, the classic sort of Greek model of the flawed hero. And then that kicked off the series where he, it's funny, it always amused me that the whole concept of the series was, here was a guy that was trying to make the series end, you know. My hero every week was out there working as hard as he could to try to make it go away, man. And it was in some measure how I felt about doing a television series about a comic book character. I didn't want to do that. I wanted to do other things, including a couple of really big classic miniseries that I had in mind, which were supposed to be a trade-off for doing the Hulk. I said to Frank Price, okay, I'll do the Incredible Hulk for you, but I'd like to do a miniseries of Ivanhoe. And he said, that's great, Kenny, do the Incredible Hulk. And so I wrote the pilot for the Incredible Hulk, 130 pages or so, Ryan, in 7 days, start to finish, and we shot the first draft screenplay, and it became a huge hit. It was released overseas as a foreign theatrical movie, and made a whole lot of money for Universal overseas as a movie in the theaters. But by the time we were moving along and I had written Ivanhoe and gotten it ready to go, Frank was no longer at Universal. And the new guy said, I didn't make that deal. I don't want to do that. And it was my first lesson in trying to get it on paper as opposed to just a handshake, because sometimes the hand you shake that makes the deal, that hand is no longer around to write the script, to write the signature on the check when you need the project done. So, but I don't mean to disparage the Hulk at all, in the sense that I really loved what we did. I loved working with Bill Bixby and Lou Ferrigno, who's still a dear close friend, and the late Jack Colvin, who played our Inspector Javert, Mr. McGee in Pursuit. And it was, and it's funny that one line that I wrote about, don't make me angry, you wouldn't like me when I'm angry.
Mr. McGee, don't make me angry. You wouldn't like me when I'm angry.
You know, sort of became a catchphrase, and has sort of stuck in the public's consciousness. It's been really, really intriguing. But I was very, very proud of the work that we did. It became an Emmy-winning show on the on CBS when I was doing the series. And so many people have said, wouldn't you like to go back and remake it? And I said, only if you can bring back Bill Bixby and Jack Colvin. You know, Lou is still around, and Lou can still do it. He still looks phenomenal. You know, but no, 5 years of it was plenty.
Well, this is what I find interesting, is that, you know, the $6 Million Man was something that you really kind of fell into. And then you fell into writing The Bionic Woman.
Right.
You didn't want to make The Incredible Hulk at first. And then when you get to V, that was something that you imagined as a very realistic fascist uprising here on Earth. And then they took the story and someone said, well, what about aliens?
So that's right.
The pattern seems to be that science fiction keeps finding you. You never really sought it out.
No, that's really true. And it's, I mean, when I was a kid, I read a lot of different things. I did enjoy science fiction a lot. I mean, that's what 12 to 14-year-old boys do particularly. But as I remember the first novel that I stayed up late, almost all night reading because I couldn't put it down, was Jules Verne's Journey to the Center of the Earth. You know, I mean, I was so hooked into that story, and Arne Saknussemm going down into the bowels of the earth, and Verne's writing was so energetic and exciting and just carried you forward from one story, one episode to the next in the story. And I read a lot of Verne's work when I was a kid, my longtime composer friend Joe Harnell used to have a little sign on his piano that said, "Bloom where you're planted." And I thought, wow, that's an interesting concept. So whatever gig you can get, let's see what you can do with it and see if you can make something, you know, make chopped liver out of chicken shit, you know, where you can really take something that you don't really can't be that interested in and figure out a way to get into it and get your heart into it. That was something I've always been striving to do, and I have had some success at taking larger than life concepts, and the reason that most of them fortunately had become so sort of successful and iconic in some ways is because I've tried to always inject into them that sort of depth and substance and social consciousness and literature too, for that matter. And I think that it gives the work more sort of weight and just fills out the drama a little more than just being sort of comic book originated.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Yeah, and that led to a lot. That led to a lot of success in the 70s and 80s with the Incredible Hulk and V, and developing the Alien Nation TV series. And then once we get into the 90s, getting the job to write and direct Steel. Let's talk about Steel for a second. 1997.
Sure. Well, what happened was that Joel Simon was a producer. He and his partner Bill Todman. They had come to me, actually, in the late 90s with a comic book premise, and I said, oh, God. It was a really pretty interesting comic book, and I really saw that it was developing characters that I would have been very much in sync with. It had a lot to do with the kind of subtext of Alien Nation and how Alien Nation was really about prejudice and discrimination and intolerance. And this comic book that they brought me was about all of that stuff, too. But I said, guys, it's too big for... They wanted it as a TV series. And I said, you can't afford to do this as a TV series. It's going to take too much money to do the effects that are going to be realistic and believable. I said, well, let's make it as a movie. And they said, no, we want it to be a TV series. And I said, well, I got to pass then, as much as I really like the material, because you can't do it right as a TV series. And a few years later, I guess they finally figured that out, because they sold it to Bryan Singer, and he made the X-Men movie. And that's what it was. And I was, when I saw it, I loved it. I thought he did exactly with it what I would like to have done, and had the money that he needed. But Joel Simon and I had stayed in touch over the years, and I got a call from him out of the blue one day, and he said, listen, Kenny, I'm sitting here with Quincy Jones, and Quincy was on the phone too. I had not met Quincy, but of course, had a great respect for him and his work as a musician and a producer as well. And they said, look, we got this project. It's a comic book, but it's about a real guy. It's about a real, not a superhero, and he's black. And I said, okay. It sounded more and more interesting. So I sat down with them at Warner Brothers and looked at the comic book, which was very gruesome. It was really an R-rated comic book. It was about this guy that had developed weapons in the army, and then the weapons get co-opted by street gangs, and he ends up making himself a suit of armor to sort of protect himself while he tries to get these weapons off the street. It was kind of a poor man's Iron Man, but without Robert Downey Jr. And the first thing I asked them was, who's going to star? And they said, well, we got Shaquille O'Neal attached to play the lead. And I said, now, Shaquille had just signed his deal with the Lakers at that time for his $250 million contract. And I said, okay, well, I've seen Kazam and a couple of things that Shaq has been in. He's really not an actor. He said, no, but he'd be great as the lead guy. And I said, okay, I'll buy that, but who's going to star? Because Shaq's not a movie star, He's not going to draw people into the theater. And they said, well, we think the concept... No, I said, no, the concept is not going to make the movie successful. They said, let me have some supporting players that are going to help you guys open the movie. And they just didn't want to spend the money, Ryan. And it was very frustrating. And I kept after them. Because Shaq was great, and we had a wonderful time working together. He was only 24 years old. When you're working with a guy that's 7.5 feet tall, you forget that he's a kid. He's 24, and he had the sensibilities of a kid, but at the same time, he was really, really dedicated, and we had fun doing it. But all the way through the movie, Ryan, I'm going, we're making a great little movie for the money that we had. It was about $21 million or something. And it looked pretty, pretty sharp, and had some family stuff, and it was all tied in with a younger brother and everything. And a good family kind of picture. And when we finished the picture, we previewed it at one place, and they brought in an audience of, it was like all teenagers or something. And it didn't preview very well. And I said, guys, you're pitching it to the wrong audience. I said, let's come back into the same theater next week and bring in a family audience. Okay. parents and younger kids and see what happens. And they did that, and it was explosive. The reviews were great. The ratings were great. And they tested it in 60 theaters around the country, Ryan. And it just was in the 80-90 percentile, which is exactly, it's the dream place to be, you know? And I'm thinking, I don't think so, because they're getting in for free. You know, is anybody going to pay to see Shaq do this? And I was right, man. I hate it when I'm right sometimes. And our movie opened in the theaters, and nobody came. You know, and it was like... And right after that, the whole marketing department at Warner Brothers got fired because of it. One of the two co-presidents at Warner Brothers, Billy Gerber, got fired, which was particularly interesting because it was the other president, Lorenzo de Bonaventura, who had really been behind the movie of Steel. Billy was sort of a collateral damage, I guess. And a couple of months after that, I called Billy and I said, "Can I take you to lunch?" And we were sitting at lunch, and I said, "Why in the world did you let that happen? Why didn't you put a?" And he said, "You know what, Kenny? Up until the week before you started filming, we were really talking about pulling Shaq out of the movie and putting in a star, you know, a Wesley Snipes at that time, or Denzel even, or somebody like that." And I said, "Why didn't you, Billy?" And he said, "Well, because the marketing department really told us they were convinced that they could sell more toys with Shaq than they could sell toys with one of the others, Wesley or somebody." And I said, "Oh, my God, Billy, not if the movie doesn't open." You know, was this the first time you'd done it? I mean, yeah, it was crazy, Ryan. And it was frustrating because we made a good little movie that family audiences really loved, and had we had somebody in there that would have drawn people into the theaters, clearly I think it would have done a lot better than it did.
Mm-hmm. Well, on the plus side of all that is you got to work with Quincy Jones. I mean, that to me is what I would have taken from the whole experience.
Well, yeah, Quincy was great. He wasn't there very much. He was only there at the very first meeting, and then when we got to the scoring, he helped. He actually pushed upon me a young composer that had never done a film score before. So I had a lot of educating that I had to do along the way. And Quincy helped with that too. But it's not like Quincy was not in the trenches with us. He was above that. But just working with him, you know, you're right. I mean, it was terrific.
Yeah. Well, and that brings us up to late 90s, in which one of the things that you did that a lot of people my age will remember you for and remember is a couple of Disney Channel original movies that you did. And I grew up, you know, on a lot of those. A lot of them like Brink and Halloween Town and all those stuff. The two that
right.
you did were two of the ones that stick out in my memory. Xenon Girl, the 21st Century, and Don't Look Under the
Don't
Bed.
Don't Look Under the Bed.
Right.
Right, yeah.
So if you, yeah, go ahead and tell us about those.
Yeah, well, it's funny. I got a call. Where was I? I guess I was just finishing up. It was right after Steel and Alien Nation had just finished up, and I was in the middle of putting some other stuff together. And I got a call one afternoon from Suzanne DePass. Suzanne and I had danced together a number of times, but never been able to get a project off the ground. She was and still is an incredibly smart person. She was. At Motown, but she was Berry Gordy's right-hand person. Suzanne DePass is the woman that discovered the Jackson 5, you know, and she was with Berry Gordy all through the heyday of Motown, and then decided that she wanted to be a producer in film and TV. And we had a couple of, as I said, several times, almost been able to work together. She had a script that she loved, that I loved, and we couldn't get the funding for it. And then I would bring her some stuff and back and forth. And so we'd been, as I said, sort of dancing with each other for 3 or 4 years. But I hadn't heard from her in a while. And the phone rings, and it's Suzanne. She's up in Vancouver. And she says, "Kenny, I'm in deep trouble. I need your help." I said, "Okay, how can I help?" And she said, "I'm doing this movie called Xenon Girl of the 21st Century. We're up here. We've already started the prep, and the director doesn't know what he's doing, and I have just fired him. And I need you to, can you get on a plane right now?" And I said, "I got to move some things around." But I said, "Are you going to be there and we're actually going to get to work together?" And she said, "Yes, absolutely." I said, "Okay, let me get on the phone and see what I can do." And literally the next day I was on the plane to Vancouver. And it all sort of came together that quickly. They'd already started building the sets. They already had a budget and a production design and a number of people on the staff. But they had not yet cast the leading lady, really the bulk of the casting had yet to be done. And they had some people that they really liked. I said, okay, well, let me see who you really like. Let's start there. Make it as easy as we can. And one of the first people they introduced me to was Kirsten, Kirsten Storm, who ended up playing Xenon. And she was a beautiful little girl, 14 years old, and very sweet and very personable and very eager to work. But as I read the scenes with her, I just didn't feel that she was going to have the strength to carry it as an actress. And on the other hand, I had met Raven Simone, and I said to the folks at the channel, I said, look, let's put Raven in the lead. She's an actress. She can really do this. I said, no, but we really love Kirsten. But I decided that after I worked with her a little bit more, I said, all right, look, give me a couple of weeks of rehearsal up there in Vancouver with her before we start, just her and me and a script supervisor, so that I can really try to get her head into the role. And I did that, and we did, and she came up to it, and we ended up making it, pulling it together, and it was good. The funny thing though is, it was a little bit of the Quincy Jones syndrome with Suzanne, because I kept saying, where are you? Why are you not up here on the set with me? she was busy doing other things down in Hollywood. So we did not end up side by side working together as I really wanted to, because she's so smart and such a dynamo. And I really would have valued her moment to moment input while we were doing it together. She was there when she needed to be, and it worked out. It was, and I'm always amazed by the film students that I have. I teach occasionally at USC and UCLA, and the current most recently at the New York Film Academy out here in LA, Loyola, and a few other places. And I'm always startled by how many of the young students just. When I start running clips from Xenon and Don't Look Under the Bed, they all go, "Wow, man, you did that! Wow, I love that show!" it was a fun thing to do and challenging. The other challenge too, when you're doing a show like that, Ryan, for Disney, is that most all of the cast is 14 years old. Mm-hmm. And the problem is, as a filmmaker, you need to be shooting about 12 or 13, 14 hours a day. But you only get the kid for about 8 hours a day, and you got to take out their lunchtime, and you got to give them an hour of rest and recreation, and it's like, how do you schedule a shooting for a 13-hour day when you only have your principal players for 8 hours? And so you're stuck with having to use photo doubles and shooting over the shoulder and shooting out, we'd shoot all of Raven's angles and then she'd be gone and we'd be shooting over somebody else's shoulder looking back at Kirsten for her time. And she would have come later into the day. Oh, it was not easy to do. And one of the real challenges of shooting for any of the Disney movies was trying to figure out how you can put it together in the time that you have. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I Don't Look Under the Bed, but I mean, they were a little bit older in that movie.
Well, the beauty, it was so funny. First of all, they wanted to go back to Vancouver, Disney did, and I said, look, guys, can't we do this in the States and give some Americans a paycheck, And they said, well, it's too expensive to do it in Hollywood, and I was looking around, and I knew that there was some non-union stuff where crews were partially non-union that were shooting in Salt Lake City. And they had just finished the crew that was just finishing the series of Touched by an Angel, I knew was coming available, and I said, "Look, let's shoot in Salt Lake. At least we're in America, and we can give some Americans jobs." And we checked it out, and budget wise, and crew wise, and everything, and it all fell together. So I was going to obviously planning to cast the leading roles out of Los Angeles because there's a much deeper actor and talent pool here in Los Angeles than there is in Salt Lake. But I was reading for some of the smaller roles in Salt Lake, and this girl came in to read for one of the smaller roles. Her name was Erin, and Erin Chambers, a little cute little 14-year-old redhead, right? And she read like really well. She was so good. I said, God, let's have her come back and read for the lead. And I said, would you come back and read? She said, sure, I'd love to come back and read. And I'm looking at her resume, and I see that at the bottom of the resume, it says she's a sophomore at Brigham Young University. And I said, wait a minute. I said, Erin, how old are you? And she said, do I have to tell you? And I said, yes. And she said, well, I'm 18. And I went, woo, this is great. This is the best, because here's an actress that looks like she's 14, absolutely, but isn't. She's 18, and I own her for 13 hours if I need her every day, you know. And then when Ty came in to read for the role of Larry, he just blew us out of the room. He was sensational. Brought this tremendous energy, exactly like you saw in the film. And I said, okay, this has got to be the guy. And I said, they're going to be a great pair. And I said, how old are you, Ty? And he said, well, I'm 17. And I went, oh shit, you know, just missed. I said, when do you turn 18? Well, it turned out that he turned 18 about 1 week into our filming. So that we had a big birthday party for him that day on the show and said, congratulations, happy birthday, and by the way, you're working all night tonight, you know, which is something you can't do with a 14 or a 17-year-old. So so the two of them together were just electric. One of the things that had drawn me to the script when I initially read it was that it was a little more deep philosophically than the other Disney Channel movies that I had seen, or certainly than Xenon was, and it got into some pretty heady psychological stuff that I thought was really, really interesting, and so it was it really delved into your subconscious a little bit, and where boogeymen come from and why. And there's a couple of interesting aspects about one of the things that I love to talk about, and that haven't had the opportunity to talk about to many people. And that is, at the end of the movie, one of the Disney execs called and said, well, what are you going to do about the end of the movie? And I said, what about the end of the movie? They said, well, they kiss. And I said, yeah. And he said, well, yeah, but, I said, but what? He said, well, she's white and he's black. And I said, yeah. And, you know, and they said, well, we're not sure how well that's going to go over, particularly in the South, in the South parts of America. You know, I said, oh, please, guys. I mean, what were we in the year 2000? We were in the 21st century, I think, by then. And it was like, or close to it. And as I said, guys, get a life. You know, he's going to kiss her at the end of the movie, and it's an important moment. It's a story point in the movie. And, well, could you shoot it a couple of different ways? And I said, I'm going to shoot it the way I'm going to shoot it, you know, guys. And so we did. And of course, it was fine. And nobody has ever said, oh, my God, what this, you know, interracial thing, good God. It was, but it was really peculiar that far into our history that the studio was still, you know, sort of nervous about it. And the other thing that happened was that it was the first Disney Channel movie that was not a G-rated movie. I don't know if you know that. It was a PG movie. It was the first time they'd ever done a PG movie on the Disney Channel. And they even ran a disclaimer at the beginning of it because there's some scary things in it. And, I mean, it is, hello, the Halloween movie, but always they'd been a little lighter-handed. So they ran a disclaimer at the beginning of every time it aired on the channel. But still, they got a lot of angry mail from people saying, oh, this was too scary for little kids. Well, why didn't you read the disclaimer, people? The channel was sort of frustrated about that, but it's hung on, and like you say, it's one of those titles from the Disney Channel that always seems to pop up. People always talk to me about, of course, High School Musical, and I didn't have anything to do with, but I wish I had. It would have been fun. but Xenon and Don't Look Under the Bed both really hang on. And Erin now, incidentally, is married and has two kids. She did an audio book, a voice in one of the novels that I did. We did an audio book version, and she came in when she was about 8 months pregnant, and she still looks like she's 14 years old. It's amazing.
So no further discussions with Disney after that, or was it just those two, or they didn't talk to you about doing Xenon?
No, I did those two. I wrote another script for them that it was a story that I'd been trying to get made for some time that they were really interested in, but ultimately just decided it was just a little too adult for the channel. And then the management changed there. The guy that I had been working with primarily went on to somewhere else, and so the sort of team that I had been working with fell apart, and the new people came in, and they always bring in other new people that they like, and so I never went back. I would have been happy to talk to them about most anything if I could find a way into the script that would make me that I could really see why it was worth me doing it. I would have, but we never were. I never worked over there again.
Well, you've kept busy since then. You've directed lots of television since then, including episodes of JAG. And I know that in recent years you've published novels. You've published a sequel to V.
Right.
And you've been working on getting turned that into a movie. So is that basically what takes up most of your time these days?
Yeah, it has been. I've really been focused on V and on the movie trilogy. And we had it set up now. When the word first got out about 5 or 6 years ago that I owned the motion picture rights, I said suddenly had a lot of new best friends, as happens in this town. Well, Kenny, I'd love to talk to you. Here's an offer for gazillions of dollars, and we'd like to buy the rights. And all the major studios came at me to buy the rights for really an obscenely large amount of money, Ryan. But you know what? I had seen what had happened, but I was fearful of getting edged out of the filmmaker chair. I was nervous but just edgy about the idea, and I'd seen it happen to other people and friends even in Hollywood, where suddenly the guy who's really the creative force of the show and really understands it better than anybody else gets kind of edged over to the side. And happened to Frank Darabont recently on Walking Dead, who was a brilliant talent, and just sort of got edged out. And in that case, the show managed to go on and be pretty successful, but a lot of times it doesn't. And it certainly didn't with the Incredible Hulk movies, or with when they tried to revive my Bionic Woman and reinvent it. It was a disaster after they spent, $3 or $4 or $5 million advertising it and all of that. And then the same thing almost exactly happened when they tried to revive V in 2009 at ABC. Where again, it's a title that everybody loves and remembers, but when people tuned in that first night, they said, "Oh, we wanted to see more V, but not this V." And then the ratings fell off and just continued to drop like a rock for the next three episodes. And then they pulled it off the air entirely, fired the whole writing staff, brought in another whole executive producer and writing staff, put it back on the air the following March. Like 7-6 months later, following Lost, the lead-in for the show was now Lost, which was their biggest show, right? And when V came back on following Lost, it had lower ratings than when it had gone off the air in September, October, because they just didn't get it. And so I decided that I didn't want to give away. I didn't, in spite of all the money I was being offered, I just did not want to give up the rights to make V the way that it should have been made. I decided, it was my wife Susie actually who put it into perspective. She said, "Look, would you rather that the movie of V never got made than to see it get made the wrong way by the wrong people?" And I said, "That's it, Susie. You nailed it. That's exactly right. I don't want that to happen." And so we've been holding out, trying to put it together as an independent feature using private equity funding. We've had it in place twice, maybe three times, I guess, once with Chinese funds, once with Indian funds. And then about a year and a half ago, this pharmaceutical billionaire bought the rights to the old Desilu Studios. And somehow he found out that I was looking for, and he invited us in, and he said, okay, we're going to make this. We're going to do the whole V trilogy. It's going to be our flagship movie production of the new Desilu Studios. And he even put cash money on the barrel head that was non-refundable. And we started prepping. I mean, we were moving down the road. And about 2 months into it, Ryan, the Hollywood Reporter did this big investigative reporting and expose of the fact that this guy was a sham, that he didn't really have all the money that he claimed to have. In fact, the money that he had given us, fortunately it was non-refundable, he had borrowed from somebody else to give us, you know. So it was like, oh, shit, because they'd done this big hoopla and a big Hollywood announcement and press and all that sort of stuff, and then, oh, don't look behind the curtain. There's nobody behind the curtain. You know, it was frustrating. So since then, we've been close again, and we are now, but I... You know when I believe it, Ryan, is when I'm on the set with my breakfast burrito in my hand and I see the trucks are surrounding me and I know that the cast is in makeup, and then at that point I allow myself to say, this might really happen, you know, but until I'm saying action on the set, I never believe it. But we're running at it, and hopefully we'll get there.
Oh, cool. Ed, good luck with that. I know you also have a novel out, Man of Legends, and...
Yes, there's two, actually. A Man of Legends became a bestseller on Amazon, and a new novel that is out now called The Darwin Variant, which is also kind of a thriller kind of thing, and kind of interesting little subtext there going on. Anyway, I hope this has given you some stuff to chew on, and that it works okay for you.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, that'll do us for today. Mr. Kenneth Johnson, longtime film and TV maker and author. Thank you, Mr. Johnson, for joining us. And for you guys watching, and sorry, it's been so long since I've done this. For those of you watching, thank you for keeping it real with ReelTime.
Thanks, Ryan. Supernova girl, make my heart go, my supernova girl.